So welcome back. So in this course, we're going to be focusing on crystalline semiconductors. And before we continue, there's one technical detail that we need to discuss, and that is, how do we specify planes and directions in crystal semiconductors? There's a very convenient and easy way to do this. It's especially easy for cubic systems like silicon, and it's called Miller indices. So the goal in this lecture is to understand what Miller indices are all about. So here is our silicon crystal, and the question is, how do we specify the various planes and the various directions in a crystal like this? And there's a very simple prescription, and we'll go through that prescription. So here's a plane. Here's the X, Y, and Z directions. And I'm doing everything in terms of the lattice spacing A in the crystalline, in the cubic crystal system. So you can see that the X, Y, and Z intercepts are 2 in the X direction, 1A in the Y direction, and 2A in the Z direction. There's no need to carry the A around because we understand that everything is measured in units of A. So we can express these intercepts as 2, 1, 2. That's the first step of our prescription. The next step of the prescription is to invert those. So 2 becomes 1 half, 1 becomes 1, 2 becomes 1 half. So now we have a set of inverted indices. And the final step in our prescription then is to rationalize them. Make each one of these a number. You can see if we multiply everything by 2, then we have a set of numbers. 1, 2, 1. That's how we'll define this plane. We will put those numbers in parentheses. The parentheses mean we're talking about a plane. This plane here, we would refer to as a 1-2-1 plane. Okay. Now, you might ask, okay, that's a simple enough prescription. You know, how do I remember it? Where does it come from? Well, we can remember it if we understand the equation for a plane. So if you'll recall your high school algebra, you can remember that one way to describe planes is with an equation of this form. A plane is described by x over the x-intercept of the plane, y over the y-intercept plus z over the z-intercept equals 1. That is one way to write the equation of a plane. You can see that the important elements of this equation are the three numbers 1 over x-intercept plus 1 over y-intercept plus 1 over z-intercept. Since we're doing everything in units of lattice spacing, we can express each of those intercepts in units of the lattice spacing, and then we can rationalize them to make a set of numbers, and that's where the prescription for Miller indices planes comes from. Now, to get familiar with this, I urge you to have a look at the homework problems, work through a few of these, and then it will become very simple and clear to you. Well, we also would like to describe directions in crystal lattices. So what we want to do is to describe the direction of a vector in a crystal lattice. You'll remember that the way we specify a vector is we give its x component, y component, and z component. So this particular vector has a x component of 2a, a y component of 2a, and a z component of 3a. So we would describe those three components as 2a, 2a, and 3a. But again, we're doing everything in terms of lattice spacing, so there's no need to carry the A around with us. And we can just describe this vector by the intercepts 2, 2, and 3. So the first step was to remember the equation of a vector. The second step is to identify its components. The third step is to drop the lattice spacing A, which is the same in all directions. We then enclose those numbers in square brackets. The square brackets indicate that we are talking about a vector and not a plane. Now, one of the other things that we're going to want to be able to do is we're going to want to understand, if we have a plane, what direction is the normal to that plane? What direction is perpendicular to the surface of that plane? Turns out the answer is very simple. The vector 1, 2, 1 is perpendicular to the plane 1, 2, 1. So that's nice and easy to remember and simple. You might ask, why is that so? So again, we can understand where that comes from if we go back to the equation of our plane. You may recall that the way we deduce the vector that is normal to a plane is we take the gradient. The gradient is the derivative with respect to x in the x direction, plus the derivative with respect to y in the y direction, plus the derivative with respect to z in the z direction. If we go ahead and do that, perform that gradient on this function, we'll find that the normal is 1 over x-intercept in the x-direction, 1 over y-intercept in the y-direction, 1 over z-intercept in the z-direction, and that's just the vector that we describe as normal vector 1, 2, 1. So that's where this prescription comes from, and it's convenient and easy to do. Okay, there are even more things we can do with this convenient Miller notation. We might ask ourselves, for example, if we have a 100 plane of silicon and a 111 plane of silicon, what is the angle between these two planes? By the way, there are various etchants, like KOH, that preferentially etch certain crystal directions, so we can actually produce structures like this, and they occur in some semiconductor applications. Well, the normal to the 100 plane is the 100 direction. The normal to the 111 plane is the 111 direction. So the angle between the planes is the angle between these two normals. Now, you'll remember that if I take the dot product of two vectors, that's the magnitude of the first vector times the magnitude of the second vector times the cosine of the angle between them. So understanding that dot product means that I can solve for the cosine of the angle between these two vectors, or the cosine of the angle between the two planes. So working that out, we have cosine theta equals n1 dot n2 over the magnitude of n1 times the magnitude of n2. We describe n1 by three indices, h1, k1, l1. We describe n2 by three other indices. We remember that the way we take the dot product is we multiply the x components, multiply the y components and add them, multiply the z components and add that to the total. You'll remember that the way we take the magnitude of a vector is we take the square root of the x component squared plus the y component squared plus the z component squared. So we have a formula that gives us the cosine of the angle between those two planes. We take the arc cosine or the inverse cosine, and we have the angle. So just as an example, in this particular example, we had a 100 plane, vector n1 is normal to that, a 111 plane, vector n2 is normal to that. We have a prescription now. We take the dot product on the top. We take the magnitude of those two vectors on the bottom. We find cosine theta is 1 over square root of 3. We take the arc cosine theta, and we find that the angle between those two planes is 54.7 degrees. And as I mentioned earlier, this is something that can actually be produced by various types of etchants in silicon. So our notation is that we describe planes by three integers. We enclose it in parentheses when then we're talking about a specific plane. We can describe the direction normal to the plane by a vector, HKL. We put it in square brackets to indicate that we're talking about a vector. Now, there's also a way to describe a set of equivalent planes and a way to describe a set of equivalent circuits. The notation is just a little different, and I'll explain where that comes from also. So let's look at this plane. If you look at this plane and you apply our prescription, you should be able to convince yourself that this is a 0-1-0 plane. Now, you might ask, well, what if you move the intercept over from A to 2A? If you do that, our prescription, you'll find that it's also a 0-1-0 plane. Really, they're the same plane, because if we have a crystal lattice where every point is the same as every other point, I could just as easily move my origin from here to here, and that second plane would look the same. Okay, so this is a 0-1-0 plane. It's enclosed in parentheses to indicate that I'm talking about one specific plane. You know, what plane is this? The intercept on the y-axis is at minus a. If you go through our prescription, you'll find that the answer is 0-1-0. Actually, we don't write it that way in Miller indices notation. Instead of writing the 1, the minus here, we put a bar over the 1. So this would be a 0-1-bar-0 plane. Okay. Now, if you look at these planes are really all the same. There's a whole set of planes whose normals are in the x, y, and z direction, and they're all the same because the crystal lattice is symmetric. If I rotate the lattice by 90 degrees or 180 degrees or 270 degrees, everything looks the same. Nothing has changed. So all of these specific planes are really the same. So we would put these numbers then in a set of squiggly parentheses or brackets to indicate that we're not talking about just about one specific plane, but we're talking about all of these that are crystallographically equivalent to this plane. Okay. Now, if I look at this plane, we can again work through our prescription. I encourage you to do that. You'll find that this is a 1-1-0 plane. If I ask you, what is this direction normal to the plane? Well, we know that that's a 1-1-0 direction. Okay, so now we can do some other calculations on the crystal lattice that are actually quite useful. We can ask ourselves different questions. For example, if we're building an electronic device on the surface of a silicon wafer, we might need to know how many atoms there are per square centimeter on the surface. So to do that, let's say that this is the surface of my electronic device, and I want to count the number of atoms per square centimeter. Well, on that face, there are 4 atoms on the corner, but they're shared with cubes that are adjacent to it, so I can only count 1/4 of each of those atoms with this particular face. There's also an atom right in the middle. That's not shared with anything because I'm talking about a surface here. There's no cube above it. So the number of atoms on this face is 4 × 1/4 for the ones on the corners, plus 1, the one in the middle. So there are 2 atoms on the 100 plane of this silicon lattice. If I want to know the density of atoms per square centimeter, it's 2 divided by the area of that face. I plug in numbers for A and compute it. I find that it's 6.8 × 10^14 atoms per square centimeter. And you can do this on various other planes, 1-1-0 planes, 1-1-1 planes, and you'll find that there are different numbers. So just to summarize, Miller indices provide a simple way to describe both planes and directions in crystal lattices. It's something that the prescription is easy to understand, and it's easy to remember if you work through several examples and get the hang of it. So I'd encourage you to have a look at the homework and spend a little bit of time in that. For cubic systems, we have a very simple prescription. And just to summarize then, the notation HKL in parentheses means we're talking about a specific plane. The notation HKL in square brackets means we're talking about a vector. In fact, it's the vector normal to this specific plane. The set of integers HKL in curly brackets is a set of crystallographically equivalent planes. And the set HKL in these kinds of brackets are a set of crystallographically equivalent directions. So remember, the X direction is equivalent to the Y direction, is equivalent to the Z direction, because if I rotate a cubic crystal, everything looks the same. So this is the way we will refer to various planes and directions from time to time in this course. This is the way semiconductor people do it. We have covered a lot of ground in these lectures, and now we're ready in the next lecture to actually begin to talk about some properties of common semiconductors and dive a little bit deeper.